Hello everyone, welcome to the second lecture of Module 5 on the Information Technology Act 2000. Coming to the outline of this video, firstly we'll go through the digital signature certificate, its issuance, suspension and its revocation. Next we'll list out the duties of a subscriber. Next, the penalties need to be paid with respect to some deeds under the IT Act 2000. Finally, the complete working of Cyber Appellate Tribunal will be studied. So firstly, we'll go through digital signature certificates. So under this, we'll be studying five topics, that is certifying authority to issue digital signature certificate, next representation upon issuance of digital signature certificate, suspension of digital signature certificate, its revocation, and finally the notice of suspension or revocation. So first we'll go through what is digital signature certificate. Digital signature certificate is a certificate issued by a certifying authority, that is a CA, necessary for undertaking to be able to digitally sign a document. That is, it's a certificate which is basically used to digitally sign a document, and who will be issuing it? It is a certifying authority. So next we'll see how a digital signature certificate is issued for any person or for any organization. First, any person may make an application to the certifying authority for the issue of digital signature certificate in such form as may be prescribed by the central government. It means that every certifying authority, CA, will be having their format in order where a person can fill the application along with the required document and give it to the certifying authority telling that I want a digital certificate. Second, every such application shall be accompanied by such fees not exceeding 25,000 rupees as may be prescribed by the central government to be paid to the certifying authority. However, while prescribing fees under section subsection 2, different fees may be prescribed for different classes of application. It means that they say that for every application, a minimum fees will be there but not exceeding 25,000 rupees, and it depends on the applicant who is applying it. Means if it is for an individual, there will be a separate category how much they need to pay. Similarly, if it is for an entire organization, the fees will be different. So it depends on the applicant for what purpose he is applying. So based on that, amount will be fixed by the central government for a certifying authority. Now, third point, every such application shall be accompanied by a certification practice statement, or where there is no such statement, a statement containing such particulars as may be specified by the regulation. So it means that every applicant who will apply for a digital signature certificate need to also place a statement telling that for what purpose the digital signature certificate is used, for what kind of documents the applicant want to use a digital signature need to be specified. So fourth point, on reception of the application under subsection 1, the certifying authority may, after consideration of the certification practice statement or the other statement under subsection, and after making such enquiries as it may deem fit, grant the digital signature certificate or for reasons to be recorded in writing reject the application. So it means that once the CA has received the applicant along with the practice statement, now the CA can basically accept the digital certificate or he might reject the issuing of digital certificate. So on rejecting, he should give in writing why the application has been rejected. So provided that no digital certificate shall be granted unless the certifying authority is satisfied. So for rejecting, he has to give the reason. For acceptance, he need to follow these four conditions. So what are they? The applicant holds the private key corresponding to the public key to be listed in the digital signature certificate. So while applying for a digital certificate, he has to send the public key. So now the certifying authority also need to know that there is a corresponding private key for the public key that is being sent. So the applicant need to prove that. Next, the applicant holds a private key which is capable of creating a digital signature. Third one, the public key to be listed in the certificate can be used to verify a digital signature affixed by the private key held by the applicant. Fourth one, however, no applicant shall be rejected unless the applicant has been given a reasonable opportunity of showing cause against the proposed rejection. So these are the four conditions need to be followed in order for the CA to approve giving a digital certificate for any person. Next, representations upon issuance of digital signature certificate. So a certifying authority, while issuing a digital certificate, need to verify the following. So what are the first one? It has complied with the provisions of this act and the rules and regulations made thereunder, that it follows that the organization or the person who is the applicant need to follow the provisions that is provided by this act and he follows the rules and regulations. Second one, it has published the digital signature certificate or otherwise made it available to such person relying on it and the subscriber has accepted it. It means that the subscriber need to publish the digital signature certificate or else he need to make it available to the other person who basically relies on it in order to verify the signature. Third one, the subscriber holds the private key corresponding to the public key listed in the digital signature certificate. That is, the subscriber need to have the private key corresponding to the public key that is present in the digital signature certificate. Fourth one, the subscriber's public key and the private key constitute a functioning key pair. Fifth one, the information contained in the digital signature certificate is accurate. Lastly, it has no knowledge of any material fact which, if it had been included in the digital signature certificate, would adversely affect the reliability of the representation made in clause A to D. So next we'll go through how and when a digital signature certificate can be suspended. So first, initially, subject to the provision of subsection 2, the certifying authority which has issued a digital signature certificate may suspend such digital signature certificate, first condition, on receipt of the request to the effect from the subscriber listed in the digital signature certificate or any person duly authorized to act on behalf of that subscriber. So, a certifying authority might suspend any digital signature certificate on first condition is that if the request is directly received from the subscriber that is present or it is listed in the digital signature certificate or the other person who is duly responsible or to authorize to act on behalf of the subscriber. Any of them, from any of them, if they receive a request in order to suspend the digital certificate to the certifying authority, they will suspend the digital signature certificate. Second condition is that if it is of opinion that the digital signature certificate should be suspended in a public interest, in that case also the certifying authority can directly issue a suspension. So based on the public interest. So there are two facts on which a certifying authority might suspend a digital signature certificate. First is that request either received from the subscriber itself or the person duly authorized to act on behalf of the subscriber, any of the two. Or the last one is if they, because of some public issue, they want to suspend a digital certificate, the certifying authority can do so. Second point says that a digital signature certificate shall not be suspended for a period exceeding 15 days unless the subscriber has been given an opportunity of being heard in the matter. So it means that the suspension cannot go exceeding 15 days. It will be less than that. Before that, the matter should be clarified by both the certifying authority and the subscriber as well. Third point says that on the suspension of the digital signature certificate under this section, the certifying authority shall communicate the same to the subscriber. That is nothing but whenever the digital signature certificate is suspended, the same need to be communicated to the subscriber, telling that you are not supposed to use the public key or you are not supposed to use the private key in order to sign any document because your certificate is in suspension now. So next we'll go through when we can revoke a digital signature certificate. That is when a certifying authority can revoke a digital signature certificate. First point, a certifying authority may revoke a digital signature certificate issued by it on the following three conditions. That is, where the subscriber or any other person authorized by him makes a request to that effect, second condition upon the death of the subscriber, third condition upon the dissolution of the firm or winding up of the company where the subscriber is a firm or a company. So it means that on these three conditions, first condition says that the person or the subscriber itself want to revoke their digital certificate. In that case, second case is on the death of the subscriber. Third case is that if the subscriber is a company or a firm, in that case it is about to wind up the company, it is about to close the company, in that case the revocation of the certificate will be done. Second case, it says that a certifying authority may revoke a digital certificate which has been issued by it at any time if it is of the opinion that a material fact represented in the digital signature certificate is false and has been concealed. So first condition, the certifying authority at any time may revoke any digital certificate if any time it feels that the material or the details that is given by the applicant in the digital signature certificate is false and it is being hidden from the certifying authority. In that case, they might revoke the certificate. Second condition, a requirement for the issuance of digital signature certificate was not satisfied. There are certain requirements in order to issue a digital signature certificate and that was not provided properly. So in that case, they might revoke the digital signature certificate. Third condition, the certifying authorities private key or security system was compromised in a manner materially affecting the digital signatures certificate's reliability. It means that if the certifying authority's private key or security system was compromised, if its private key is compromised, in that case the revocation of all the digital signature certificate of that certifying authority will be basically revoked. Then the last point is the subscriber has been declared insolvent or dead, or where a subscriber is a firm or a company which has been dissolved, wound up or otherwise ceased to exist. It means that if in any case the subscriber is considered to be dead, or if it is a company, it is being wound up, in both the cases the revocation of the digital signature certificate will be done. Third point says that a digital signature certificate shall not be revoked unless the subscriber has been given an opportunity of being heard in the matter. Means without informing to the subscriber, they won't revoke the digital signature certificate. First they'll inform the subscriber, then they basically will revoke the digital signature certificate on any of the above mentioned conditions. Fourth point says that on revocation of the digital signature certificate under this section, the certifying authority shall communicate the same to the subscriber. Means before revoking, they'll inform, that is what is mentioned in the third point. After the revocation also, they'll mention that the revocation of the certificate is done. Further, don't use your private key in order to sign any document. Finally, notice of suspension and revocation. So where a digital signature certificate is suspended or revoked under the section 37 and 38, just now what we discussed, the certifying authority shall publish a notice of such suspension or revocation as the case may be in the repository specified in the digital signature certificate for publication of such notice. So every digital certificate that is being issued to an applicant, they will specify the repository in which the suspension and revocation will be published. So whenever the suspension or revocation happens, in that repository it will be mentioned whether the certificate is suspended or revoked. If it is not, if the digital signature certificate information is not specified in that repository, it means that it is not suspended or not revoked, it is in active state. If it is there in that repository, it means that it is suspended and it is revoked, or it might be revoked. Second point says that where one or more repositories are specified, the certifying authority shall publish notice of such suspension or revocation as the case may be in all such repository. If it is the case that the suspension and revocation is specified in multiple repository, then it will be published in all those repositories as well. So next we'll go through the duties of a subscriber. So there are three duties. First one is generating key pair. Next one is acceptance of digital signature certificate. Finally, the control of a private key. So we'll go through one by one. The first one, generating key pair. So where any digital signature certificate, the public key of which corresponds to the private key of that subscriber, which is to be listed in the digital signature certificate, has been accepted by the subscriber, then the subscriber shall generate the key pair by applying the security procedure. Next, acceptance of digital signature certificate by the subscriber. How it is done, we'll see. First, it says that a subscriber shall be deemed to have accepted a digital signature certificate if he publishes or authorizes the publication of digital certificate. How it is done? To either to one or more person or in a repository or otherwise demonstrate his approval of digital signature certificate in any manner. So initially, the subscriber shall prove that he has accepted the digital signature certificate if he publishes or authorizes the publication of digital signature certificate to either one or more person. He has to prove that, or else he has to place the digital signature certificate in a repository, or otherwise he can demonstrate himself proving that he has the corresponding public key for the corresponding private key for the public key that is present in the digital certificate. Next, by accepting a digital signature certificate, the subscriber certifies to all who reasonably rely on the information contained in the digital signature certificate that the subscriber holds the private key corresponding to the public key listed in the digital signature certificate and is entitled to hold the same. Second, all representations made by the subscriber to the certifying authority and all materials relevant to the information contained in the digital signature certificates are true, and all information in the digital signature certificate that is within the knowledge of the subscriber is true. That is, once he has accepted the digital certificate, the subscriber need to he has to prove that all the information that is present in the digital certificate is true, and all the representations made by the subscriber to the certifying authority, that is the materials that is present given as a part of application to the digital certificate, and whatever information contained in the digital signature certificate are true, it need to be proved to a certifying authority. Finally, the subscriber need to hold the private key that is corresponding to the public key that is listed in the digital signature certificate. So the last duty of the subscriber is the control of private key. So every subscriber shall exercise reasonable care to retain control of the private key corresponding to the public key listed in his digital signature certificate and take all steps to prevent its disclosure to a person not authorized to affix the digital signature of the subscriber. Second way is, if the private key corresponding to the public key listed in the digital signature certificate has been compromised, it means it is lost, then the subscriber shall communicate the same without any delay to the certifying authority in such manner as may be specified by the regulation. It means that if your digital signature certificate is compromised or it is known to some other third party, then immediately you need to inform to the certifying authority as it is specified in their regulations. Next, we'll go through penalties and adjudication. So under this we'll be going through six topics, that is penalty for damage to computer and computer system, compensation for failure to protect your data, penalty for failure to furnish information written, residuary penalty, power to adjudicate, last one, factors to be taken in account by the adjudicating officer. First, we'll go through penalty for damage to computer and computer system. So if any person without permission of the owner or any other person who is in charge of the computer, computer system or computer network accesses or secure access to such computer or computer system or computer networks or downloads, copies or extracts any data, computer database or information from such computer or computer system or computer network, including information or data held or stored in any removable storage medium. Third point, it means it introduces or causes to be introduced any computer contamination or computer virus into any computer, computer system or computer network, or damages or causes to be damaged any computer, computer system or computer network, data, computer database or any other programs residing in a computer, computer system or computer network, or disrupts or causes disruption of any computer, computer system and computer network, or denies or causes the denial of access to any person authorized to access any computer or computer system or computer network by any means, or provides any assistance to any person to facilitate access to computer, computer system or computer network in contravention of the provision of this act, rules and regulations made thereunder, or charges the services availed of by a person to the account of another person by tampering with or manipulating any computer, computer system or computer network, he shall be liable to pay damages by the ways of compensation not exceeding 1 crore rupees to the person so affected. So on the whole, it means that any authorized computer, computer system or computer network, if it is accessed illegally according to point 1, or you download any materials from those system, that means that with respect to the second point. Third point says that if you cause any contamination, that is introducing a virus to such system or such network. Fourth point means that you cause any damage by altering the data that is present in such computer system. Fifth point means that you cause any disruption, that is the actual working, you disturb it. That means the fifth point. Sixth point means that you cause a denial of access, means authorized person is not allowed to access the system, you deny it in any way. So seventh point means that you actually provide the other person to access your system, your computer, computer system or computer network without permission. In that case, with all these 7 points, if it is done, so you will be paid a compensation not exceeding 1 crore rupees. Next, compensation for failure to protect data. So this is with respect to corporates. So if a corporate handling any sensitive information in a computer resource owns, controls and operates in negligent in maintaining security which causes gain to the other person, in such a case the corporate shall be liable to pay damages to the aggrieved party. Next is penalty for failure to furnish information return. So if any person who is required under this act or any rules or regulations made thereunder to furnish any document or return or report to the controller or the certifying authority fails to furnish the same, he shall be liable to penalty not exceeding 150,000 rupees for each such failures. That is, your controller or might be the certifying authority asked for some information and you are not able to, you have not furnished those document or report back to them, then they might give a penalty up to 150,000 rupees. Second point says that file any return or furnish any information, books or other documents within the time specified therefore in the regulations. Fail to file return or furnish the same within the time specified therefore in the regulation, he shall be liable to a penalty not exceeding 5,000 rupees for every day during which such failure continues. So it means that if to furnish these files or information, a particular time will be given, and if the time has exceeded and you are not given those documents to authority, it might be the controller or the certifying authority, in that case every day you need to pay a fine of 5,000 rupees until the files or data is submitted. For each such failure you need to give per day 5,000 rupees. So third point says that maintain books of account or records, fails to maintain the same, he shall be liable to penalty not exceeding 10,000 rupees for every day during which the failure continues. It means that if some authority is failed to maintain the book of accounts and records, in that case he shall be liable to pay a penalty not exceeding 10,000 per day for until the failure continues. Next, residuary penalty. So whoever contravenes any rules or regulations made under this act, that is IT Act 2000, for the contravention of which no penalty has been separately provided, shall be liable to pay a compensation not exceeding 25,000 to the person affected by such contraventions. It means that some of the offenses or contraventions are already specified under this Act. If any new contraventions has come which is not mentioned in this Act, even though such contraventions will be taken into consideration and a penalty of 25,000 can be given for the person who has been affected by such contraventions. Go through power to adjudicate. So adjudicate is nothing but making a formal judgment on a disputed matter. So for the purpose of adjudging under this chapter, whether any person has committed a contravention of any of the provisions of this Act or of any rule or regulations or direction or order made thereunder, the central government shall, subject to the provision of subsection 3, appoint an officer not below the rank of a director to the government of India or an equivalent officer of the state government to be an adjudicating officer for holding an inquiry in the manner prescribed by the central government. So second point says that the adjudicating officer shall, after giving the person referred to be in subsection on a reasonable opportunity for making representation in the matter, and if on such inquiry he is satisfied that the person has committed the contravention, and he may impose such penalty or award such compensation as he thinks fit in accordance with the provision of that section. So it means that the first point says that the central government basically appoints one of the either the central officer or might be the state government officer as an adjudicating officer in order to hold an inquiry based on the contravention. The second point says that once an adjudicating officer has been appointed, now he basically need to listen to the person who has caused that contravention, and based on the inquiry then he has to decide what is the penalty need to be paid by such person. So third point says that no person shall be appointed as an adjudicating officer unless he possesses such experience in the field of information technology and legal or judicial experience has may be prescribed by the central government. So central government need to appoint an adjudicating officer such that he need to have in both the experience in terms of information technology has also in terms of judicial experience, both he should have. In that case he can give a better judgment. The fourth point says that where more than one adjudicating officers are appointed, the central government shall specify by order the matters and places with respect to which such officers shall exercise their jurisdiction. So it means that if there are more than one adjudicating officer in one region, then every such contravention that occurs in their region, they will specify who has to take care of it, that is which adjudicating officer need to take care of it, and they also specify which are the area that comes under their jurisdiction. Fifth point says every adjudicating officer shall have the power of civil court, which are conferred the cyber appellate tribunal under subsection 2 of the section 58, and all proceedings before it shall be deemed to be the judicial proceedings within the meaning of section 193 and 228 of the Indian Penal Code, and shall be deemed to be a civil court for the purpose of section 345 and 346 of the Code of Criminal Procedure according to 1973. So it means that any adjudicating officer, he feels that this matter need to be taken to the court, then it will be taken to the civil court. Next, factors to be taken in account by the adjudicating officers. So while adjudging the quantum of compensation under this chapter, the adjudicating officer shall have to due regard to the following factors. It means that when an adjudicating officer is judging any matter, he need to take care of these three factors. The first factor is that the amount of gain of unfair advantage, wherever quantifiable, made as a result of default. So wherever possible, what is the damage that has caused, if it is quantifiable one, you can take an account of it. First he has to do that. Then the amount of loss caused due to any person as a result of default. So whom this loss has caused, that need to be identified. And the last one is the repetitive nature of the default. So whether this contravention has occurred repetitively, so the person has caused an amount of loss, whether it is in a repetitive manner or whether it is first time. So based on these factors, he need to make a judgment on any contravention that is offered to an adjudicating officer. So next we'll go through the Cyber Regulations Appellate Tribunal. So it is one of the body established basically to settle certain types of dispute. Next we'll see what are the rules and regulations and how it is composed. We'll see through next slides. So first we'll go through establishment of Cyber Appellate Tribunal. So the central government shall by notification establish one or more appellate tribunal to be known as the Cyber Regulation Appellate Tribunal. So the central government by notification need to say in which places in a country we can find the Cyber Regulation Appellate Tribunal, where that is the place where the disputes with respect to this act will be handled. Next, the central government shall also specify in the notification referred to in subsection 1, that is according to point 1, the matters and places in relation to which the Cyber Appellate Tribunal may exercise its jurisdiction. That is, based on these tribunals, wherever it is established, they also specify which jurisdiction comes under them and what are the disputes, jurisdiction is basically handled by them will be again mentioned by the central government. Next, we'll go through composition of Cyber Appellate Tribunal. So, a Cyber Appellate Tribunal shall consist of one person only, referred to as the presiding officer of the Cyber Appellate Tribunal, to be appointed by notification by the central government. So it means that your Cyber Appellate Tribunal has only one officer, that is appointed by the central government, who is called as the presiding officer. Next, qualification for the appointment as a presiding officer of the Cyber Appellate Tribunal. So who can be the presiding officer of a Cyber Appellate Tribunal? What is their qualification? So a person shall not be qualified for appointment as the presiding officer of a Cyber Appellate Tribunal unless he is or has been or is qualified to be the judge of a high court, or he has been a member of Indian Legal Service or is holding or has held a post in grade 1 of that service for at least 3 years. Next, the term of office, that is, for how many years can a presiding officer work as under a Cyber Appellate Tribunal? So a presiding officer of a Cyber Appellate Tribunal shall hold office for a term of only 5 years from the date on which he enters upon his office or until he attains the age of 65 years, whichever comes earlier, that will be taken under. That means that if he has joined his office at the age of 63, then he can work up till only when his age becomes 65, that is only for 3 years. But he has joined, for example, at age of 45, then he can do up till 50, that is he can take the complete 5 years term. Next, salary allowances and other terms and conditions of services of a presiding officer. So the salary and allowances payable to and the other terms and conditions of service, including pension, gratuity and other retirement benefits of the presiding officer of the Cyber Appellate Tribunal, shall be such as may be prescribed, that is, provided that neither the salary and allowances nor the other terms and conditions of the services of the presiding officer shall be varied to his disadvantage after appointment. Next, filling up of vacancies. So if for reason other than temporary absence any vacancy occurs in the office of the presiding officer of the Cyber Appellate Tribunal, then the central government shall appoint another person in accordance with the provision of this act to fill the vacancy, and the proceedings may be continued before the Cyber Appellate Tribunal for the stage at which the vacancy is filled. So next we'll go through resignation and removal. So the first point is based on when can a presiding officer resign for his position, and second two point refers to the removal of the presiding officer, how it can be done. So the presiding officer of a Cyber Appellate Tribunal may, by notice in writing under his hand address to the central government, resign his office provided that the said presiding officer shall, unless he is permitted by the central government to relinquish his office sooner, continue to hold the office until the expiry of the 3 months from the date of receipt of such notice, or until a person duly appointed as his successor enters upon his office until the expiry of his term of office, whichever is the earlier. So it means that if a presiding officer wants to resign for his position, he has to write a letter which is handwritten. It cannot be a typed one, and it should be addressed to the central government. Now, once he has handwritten his resignation, he will be continued to work up till 3 months from the date of resignation, or until another person has been appointed for the same position. Before that, if any person is there, up till that he need to do his work, or until the expiry of the term of his office, whichever comes earliest, that will be taken into account. Now, second and third point is with respect to the removal of presiding officer. The presiding officer of a cyber appellate tribunal shall not be removed from his office except by an order by the central government on the ground of proved misbehavior or incapacity after any inquiry made by the judge of Supreme Court, in which the presiding officer concerned has been informed of the charges against him and given a reasonable opportunity of being heard in the respect of these charges. So it means that if the central government feels that there is a misbehaved conduct by the presiding officer or incapacity work of a presiding officer, then they might basically remove that presiding officer, and the inquiry of that matter is done in front of the judge of Supreme Court. Now the Supreme Court need to decide what is the charge the presiding officer need to pay against that matter, but a reasonable opportunity should be given for the presiding officer with respect to these charges. He need to say with respect to what reason this misbehave has happened. The third point is the central government may, by rules or regulation, the procedure for the investigation of misbehavior or incapacity of the aforesaid presiding officer. So the central government need to provide the procedure how the investigation need to be done for the misbehave conduct and the incapacity of work that is done by the presiding officer. Next, orders constituting appellate tribunal to be final. So no order of the central government appointing any person as the presiding officer of the cyber appellate tribunal shall be called in question in any manner, and no act or proceeding before a cyber appellate tribunal shall be called in question in any manner on the ground merely of any defect in the constitution of a cyber appellate tribunal. Next, staff of the cyber appellate tribunal. So the central government shall provide the cyber appellate tribunal with such officers and employees as the government may think fit. The officers and the employees of the cyber appellate tribunal shall discharge their functions under general superintendence of the presiding officer, and the salaries and allowances of other conditions of services of the officers and employees or the cyber appellate tribunal shall be such as may be prescribed by the central government. Next, appeal to the cyber appellate tribunal. So who can appeal to cyber appellate tribunal? So provided in subsection 2, any person aggrieved by an order made by the controller or an adjudicating officer under this act may prefer an appeal to a cyber appellate tribunal having jurisdiction in this matter. So any person basically wants to appeal to the cyber appellate tribunal, but that order has to pass through the controller or through an adjudicating officer. So no appeal shall lie to the cyber appellate tribunal from an order made by the adjudicating officer with the consent of the parties. That is, no order can be passed to the cyber appellate tribunal without the consent of the parties who are involved in that appeal. So every appeal under subsection 1 shall be filed within a period of 25 days from the date on which a copy of the order made by the controller or the adjudicating officer is received by the person aggrieved, and it shall be in such form and be accompanied by such fee as may be prescribed, provided that the cyber appellate tribunal may entertain an appeal after the expiry of the said period of 25 days if it is satisfied that there was sufficient cause for not filing it within that period. So it means that once the order has been passed by the controller or the adjudicating officer on receiving the application from the person who is aggrieved person, in that case he should appeal to the cyber appellate tribunal within a period of 25 days. If at all it has crossed the 25 days and if there is a satisfactory reason why he was not able to file, sometimes it will be accepted by the cyber appellate tribunal based on the reason. Next, on receipt of an appeal under subsection 1, the cyber appellate tribunal may, after giving the parties to the appeal an opportunity of being heard, pass such orders thereon as it thinks fit, confirming, modifying or setting aside the order appealed against. So the cyber appellate tribunal should send a copy of every order made by it to the parties to the appeal and to the concerned controller and the adjudicating officer. So it means that once an appeal comes to the cyber appellate tribunal, the dispute will be handled by them. It will give an opportunity for the parties to thereafter tell what is the reason, and based on that they will provide they will the cyber appellate tribunal will give an order against the appeal, and that order will be again given to the parties who are involved in the appeal, and also the concerned controller or the adjudicating officer it will be sent. Now, according to the sixth point, the appeal filed before the cyber appellate tribunal under the subsection 1 shall be dealt or should be dealt within a period of 6 months from the date of receipt of the appeal. Next, procedures and powers of the cyber appellate tribunal. The cyber appellate tribunal shall not be bound by the procedure laid down by the Code of Civil Procedure, but shall be guided by the principle of natural justice and subject to the other provisions of this Act. Of any rules, the cyber appellate tribunal shall have powers to regulate its own procedure, including the place at which it shall have its sittings. The cyber appellate tribunal shall have, for the purposes of discharging its function under this Act, the same powers as are vested in a civil court under the Code of Civil Procedure. While trying a suit in respect of the following matters, namely, summoning and enforcing the attendance of any person and examining him on oath, and requiring the discovery and production of the documents or other electronic records, receiving evidence on affidavits, issuing commissions for the examination of witness or documents, reviewing its decisions, dismissing an application for default or deciding its expand, any other matter which may be prescribed. Every proceeding before the cyber appellate tribunal shall be deemed to be a judicial proceeding within the meaning of section 193 and 228, and for the purpose of section 196 of the Indian Penal Code, and the cyber appellate tribunal shall be deemed to be a civil court for the purpose of the section 195 and chapter 116 of the Code of Criminal Procedure 1973. Next, right to legal representation. The appellant may either appear in person or authorized one or more legal practitioners or any of its officers to present his or its case before the cyber appellate tribunal. That is, an applicant might come in person to the court, or he might authorized one or other person or any legal practitioners, that is the lawyers, has an officers to present himself before the cyber appellate tribunal. Next, limitation. The provisions of the Limitation Act 1963 shall, as far as may be, apply to an appeal made to the cyber appellate tribunal as well. Next, civil court not to have jurisdiction. No court shall have jurisdiction to entertain any suit or proceeding in respect of any matter which an adjudicating officer appointed under this Act or the cyber appellate tribunal constituted under this Act is empowered by or under this Act to determine, and no injunction shall be granted by any court or other authority in respect of any action taken or to be taken in pursuance of any power conferred by or under this act. Next, appeal to High Court. So any person aggrieved by any decision or order by the Cyber Appellate Tribunal may file an appeal to the High Court within 60 days from the date of communication of the decision or order of the Cyber Appellate Tribunal to him on any question of the fact or law as arising out of such order, provided that the High Court may, if it is satisfied that the appellant was prevented by sufficient cause from filing the appeal within the said period, allow it to be filed within a further period not exceeding 60 days. So it means that if the appellant is not satisfied by the order that is given by the Cyber Appellate Tribunal, then he can go for the appeal for the High Court, but within the 60 days of period from the date when the order was passed by the Cyber Appellate Tribunal until you appeal for the High Court. Next, compounding of contraventions. So any contravention under this chapter may either before or after the institution of adjudication proceedings be compounded by the controller or such other officers as may be specially authorized by him in this behalf or by the adjudicating officer, as the case may be subject to such condition as the controller or such other officers or adjudicating officers may specify, provided that such a sum shall not in any case exceed the maximum amount of penalty which may be imposed under this act for the contravention so compounded. Nothing in subsection 1 shall apply to a person who commits the same or similar contravention within a period of 3 years from the date on which the first contravention committed by him was compounded. Where any contravention has been compounded under subsection 1, no proceeding or further proceedings, as the case may be, shall be taken against the person guilty of such contravention in respect of the contravention so compounded. Next, recovery of penalty. So a penalty imposed under this act, if it is not paid, shall be recovered as an arrear of the land revenue and the license or the digital signature certificate, as the case may be, shall be suspended till the penalty is paid. So it means that if the penalty is not paid, in that case either the digital signature certificate that issued to him will be suspended until the penalty will be paid, or the penalty will be recovered from the land revenue or the license. So this is about Cyber Appellate Tribunal. Thank you for watching this video.